Nation. Hey!
Here we are at the Watts Oasis, the parking lot, the hoop spot here at St. John's United Methodist Church, known as Watts Oasis. And it's such a beautiful day. I thought I would come out here with my new friend, Kev, and that we would reflect on the space that we've carved out, that we would worship God in spirit and in truth. God is everywhere, forever present. And so we join with God now to worship in the spirit and truth. Spirit of God, fall afresh on us, out of us, that the space that we've carved out on this day, that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. To God be the glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Oh,
Call to confession. Despite all that God has taught us, we still act foolishly. We are still weak. In the cross of Christ, we find forgiveness and grace. We confess our sins, trusting in God's wisdom and strength rather than our own.
Prayer of confession. Merciful God, how fickle we are. We sin against you without even knowing it. Clear us, we pray, of any unknown sin, and save us from willfully ignoring your way. Let your commandments rule and guide us. Forgive us for worshiping anyone or anything except you. Keep us faithful. Forgive us for thinking everything depends on our effort and power. For you are the God who made us and brought us into the community of faith. Help us to depend on you alone and to rest in your peace. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to join me now in a time of prayer with Kev and I. And we come here on this space knowing that God is forever present, knowing that God knows our heart, God knows our desires, but the Word of God says, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be open. God, we come in this space thanking you, God, for the beauty of this day, thanking you for the sun that you've allowed to rise up for us to feel on our face. We thank you, God, for the blue sky and its witness among us. We thank you for the people that would grace us with their presence as they walk by, as they ride by, as they drive by. God, we just come asking, God, for those that are living on the street. God, we pray for their safety. We pray, God, that you would provide a hedge around them. For your word says that no weapon formed against us shall prosper, God. And we come asking that the fence of protection would shield those that are living on the street, God, by choice, by situation, by circumstance. And God, we come asking and knowing that you are a God of grace and you are a God of mercy, and that you find us where we are, whether it's in the alley, whether it's on the parking lot, whether it's along the railroad tracks, whether it's in the comfort of our apartment, our house, our car. God, we know that you are there because you're that kind of God. And we just thank you. And God, ask that you would continue to open up doors for those that desire to walk through a door of unemployment, a door of church life, a door of family relationships. God, we just ask through the blood of Christ Jesus that your anointing would fall afresh in ways that you would give us the confidence that we need to rise up, that we need to climb higher. Through the blood of Christ Jesus, we ask that you would continue to make way for us to be at peace regardless of where we are. And God, some may look at us and make decisions and choices based on the way our hair looks, the way our clothes looks, or where we shelter ourselves, God, but we know that you look at our heart. And your word said it's not what goes into a person that defiles them, but what comes out. And God, we just thank you that indeed in the midst of life, that we can shout our hallelujahs, that we can say glory. God, we can say holy, blessed is the Lord God Almighty. And we are forever grateful. God, we're thankful how you take care of the birds. We thank you, thankful how you take care of the garden. We're thankful that God, you take care of us in ways we don't even know that we're being taken care of. You provide a sandwich. You provide a beautician. You provide law enforcement. You provide partners on this journey that would help us take it to the hoop of life. And we are forever grateful. God, we come praying for those that would lead our country, that they would look beyond themselves in a selfish way, God, but they would look at the people and our needs, our desires, our hopes, our dreams. And God, we thank you for those that run institutions, whether it's the hospital, whether it's the supermarket, whether it's those places where we go for assistance, information, resources, God, that you would bless them in ways that you would give them an attitude of gratefulness to be in service in your work of kindness, of love. And God, we come praying for St. John's, the church in Watts, with Watts at heart, God, that indeed, as we come to the space that is carved out to meet people like my friend Kev, God, that we would see in them you, the witness of you, God, for we are created in your image. And as we see Kev, as we see others, God, that we would know that we're called to gather up your kingdom, for we can all shout hallelujah, that we can all shout glory, that we can all take it to the hoop, not only on the court of this basketball oasis, God, but the hoops of life. And we are forever grateful. God, we pray for those that are sick and going through the valley of the shadow of death, that you would comfort them, that you would allow them to know that you provide peace, that you would allow them to know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And we are forever grateful. God, we pray for those that ride the metro. We pray, God, for their strength, for their witness, for their safety. And as so many places are opening up, God, we pray for the school system. We pray for the teachers. We pray for those that are making decisions about returning back to the classroom. God, but we desire to be safe. Whether we're on the streets, we desire to be safe. Whether we're in our house, we desire to be safe. Whether we're in the classroom, we desire to be safe. The church desires its parking lot to be safe. God, but we know that we only see with the natural eye, but you see with the spiritual eye. God, help us see with the spiritual eye. And we are forever grateful. To God be the glory for what you've done, what you're doing, and God, and what you're about to do. And we are forever grateful through the blood of Christ Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen.
Scripture lesson, John 2, verse 13 through 22. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their table. Making a whip of cords, he drove all them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their table. He told those who were selling doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple in 3 days, I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Me whole again, nothing.
the living God, fall afresh on me in this space, in this place, as I dialogue today with Kevin, my friend, my witness, the person that reminds me that we are all God's children. Let us pray. God, we come thanking you for this day. Allow the words of my mouth and the meditation of our collective hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen, amen, amen. All right, so Kev, this is the scripture for today. Talks about Jesus going to the temple, going to the church, if you will. But before that, Jesus, his mother, his road dogs, they all go to this wedding. And at the wedding, which was custom, is that they give you the fine wine at the beginning. You know, like in Coming to America. Yeah, yeah. I don't know if you saw Coming to America, the number two, but when they were at the party, they were dishing out Crown Royal. I don't know if you know about Crown Royal, but it comes in that little purple bag. Yeah. And when I saw that in the show, I was like, uh-oh, they hitting the hood now. They hitting the hood now. But in Jesus' time, they went to this party. And at the party, called the wedding, you know, the party after the wedding, they run out of wine. Well, it was customary that when you came to somebody's house, that you would wash your hands, because it had been a journey for you to get there. You would wash your hand, wash your feet. So there were these barrels. And Jesus' mother says to Jesus and his crew, you know what to do. Well, what does that mean? You know what to do? You know when mama look at you a certain kind of way and you know what to do? So Jesus says to her, it's not my time. And she gives that look. And Jesus says, okay, bring those barrels. And he does whatever he does. And then they dip out of the barrels. And they say, wow, this is some good wine. So Jesus had what they call what? The hookup, right? That he was connected to a source in such a way that when he took this dirty water that was in this barrel and did whatever he does through the power of his Father, God Almighty, that they said, what kind of host are you that you would serve the good wine to the end? Because see, the good wine usually comes at the beginning, so that when you get a little tipsy, that when the $2 chuck come out, you don't know what it tastes like, but you already kind of lit. So people goes, wow, you saved the good stuff for last. So we leave that scene of Jesus doing his first miracle to Jesus going to the temple. That'd be like Jesus rolling up in the church, and that Jesus see us doing some stuff that is not pleasing to his eyes. We first have to understand that in this time that Jesus found himself, that people traveled and they offered what was sacrifices. So they offered, you know, goats and doves and different things that they would offer to God through the sacrifice. And so Jesus see people selling stuff, helping the people out, because everybody needs a little help every now and then. But the people, it wasn't perhaps what they were doing, it was how they were doing. So sometimes as church people, we have to look at how we do stuff. You see, like here at St. John's, there's some water taps. And I see people bathing their dog in the water taps. I see people drinking or washing up themselves in the water taps. And that in old school church thinking is that you would cap off that water so that you wouldn't have access, so we wouldn't have this huge bill. But the Spirit of God is moving in such a way in the church and Watts, with Watts at heart, that we don't need to cap the water. We need to let people know that they can have this water, but God offers a living water. You see? That water, you can have that water. That dog can be washed in that water. Because I'm not concerned about what goes into a person, but I'm concerned about what comes out. Because the Word of God says it was what comes out that makes us who we are. So that if we're walking on the street and we don't have the common courtesy to say, hey, what's up? If we don't have the common courtesy to say, you all right? And I'm not talking like all right, like a passerby. I'm like, all right, what you eat today, my brother? What you drink today, my sister? There's something about the witness of God's people that we would pause and take time to look at the heart of a person. So Jesus gets this rope and starts swinging it. you know, start swinging this rope, telling the people to get out the synagogue. Get out. Just get out. You've turned this house into something that is not of God. So we as church people have to look at ourselves and say, what are we doing that does not bring glory to God? Now, this basketball court brings glory to God because late at night, last night about 9, they out here shooting hoops, hanging out, being positive in the witness of the church parking lot. So we, church body, people of God, we have to ask ourselves, what are we doing that if Jesus came back right now, that he would take his ropes and start swinging? We have to ask the police that's watching us, what are you doing that if Jesus came back, he would take his rope and start swinging? We have to ask the school system, what are you doing that if Jesus came back right now, what would he find you doing? Because Jesus is coming back. So as people of God, living through Christ Jesus, we don't bring our blood sacrifice because Jesus is our sacrifice. And on this first Sunday of March, the tradition would be for us to share in the body and the blood of Christ Jesus, our sacrifice, our atonement. So through Christ Jesus, we have a right to the tree of life. Through Christ Jesus, we have a right to say, Father, God, Creator, Living One, as I walk these streets, allow the blood of Jesus to cover me. As I walk these streets and lay my head in the darkness, allow your spirit to protect me in ways that I would be cared for. And we are forever grateful. So today, St. John's United Methodist Church and all those that would gather to watch this, I ask you if Jesus was to speak to you right now in a very clear way, as he spoke to the money changers there in the temple, what would be his words to us? Would he find us about our Father's business? Or would he find us hidden in a corner, waiting, scared, timid? Or will we join our sisters, our brothers, our siblings, our sisters, our aunties? I was talking to my brother and he talked about how during his addiction days, how he would roam Nickerson Gardens, how he would roam looking for that next fix, but he was giving God the praise and the glory that somebody prayed for him. And now he prays for those that would be in the lifestyle that he has been redeemed from. So sisters and brothers and siblings and people of God, we give God praise and witness for what God is doing, not only in this space, but in your life, calling you to rise up, calling you to know that it was the blood, calling you to know that God loves us enough that he sent his son Jesus, that we might have a right to our safety. We might have a right to our freedom. We might have a right. So I invite you to say yes. Not only yes to the water that comes out of the hose, but to say yes to the living water, the one that can take dirty water and turn it to the good stuff, the high-end stuff, the back room under lock and key stuff. That's what God does for us. And we are so thankful. To God be the glory on this day, that indeed there are no money changers. There's nobody selling the dove or the other animals, because Jesus gives it to us free. Freely does he give, but all we have to do is say, yes, Lord, here I am. I desire a living water. I desire to take it to the hoop and make it 100% of the time. Not 50, not 75, but with God through Christ Jesus, we can shoot a hoop 100% of the time. I'm not talking about a literal hoop. I'm talking about the hoop of life. Does that mean we're not going to have trouble? No. Does it mean we're not going to have problems? No. What it means is that we're going to have strength for our journey. To God be the glory. Let us pray. God, we come thanking you for Jesus, for his witness, for him going into that temple and using that cord to let people know this is not about God's business. Allow us, God, to center ourselves in such a way that your spirit would bring to our consciousness what is not your business. God, we recognize it's not what goes into our body that defiles us. It's what comes out. So allow us, God, the body of Christ gathered here at St. John's, not look for who's smoking what or who's doing what, God, but let us look at the offering of this living water. Because, God, it's only as a Samaritan woman met Jesus at the well did she know about the power of her life. It was only when the woman touched the hem of Jesus' garment did she understand the power of God's love for her, that even just a touch could bring her wholeness. God, there's so many people right here in this area waiting for someone to say, God loves you, and so do I. That the Jesus in you can see the Jesus in me. Oh, what a time, what a time, what a time. I thank God for my brother Kevin that has listened and nodded and allowed me, PK, Pastor Kathy, to reflect in this space, to reflect on the outsideness of this beautiful space. God, we pray for those that would come to Watts Oasis, for the basketball, for the clothes, for the food, for the water out of the hydrant. But God, I pray that in the exchange of their witness to the space, that they would see the Jesus in us and the Jesus in themselves, that we can greet one another. What's up, my brother? What's up, my sister? What's up, my auntie? What's up, my uncle? Because God loves us as we are. So I invite you, if you don't know Jesus, try him out. Just say, yes, Lord, here I am. And God will do the rest. To God be the glory. God bless you. God keep you until we meet again here, the church in Watts, with Watts at Heart.
I'm not afraid to die. Yes.
Yes, it works.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Say it again. Say His blood.
His blood still works, and I'm glad to be.
Yes, I am.
Never lost.
The blood of the Lamb. Listen, His blood still works, and I'm here to testify. God is not dead, He is still alive. The same blood that was shed way back at Calvary is the same blood that's working now for me. Oh, His blood redeems me from the stain of sin, and His blood cleanses me.